Now we will move on to lesser common neoplasms, which are infrequently seen, very rarely. Some people will see this once or twice in their career. Again, brain tumors in itself are rare. Of the brain tumors, the glial tumors are the most common ones. The other tumors are unique that they arise from each and a specific cell line, and according to the cell line we will move from one tumor to another, and I will just enumerate the most common of those. There are other tumors that I will not get into, which are more rarer tumors and are a very unusual form of tumors, which can be treated just as a general holistic approach of how you would approach a brain tumor based on my first lecture. But the most common of the rare tumors, I will go cell by cell in each different category and talk about them. From that, we will first approach the ependymal lining. This is the big lining which lines the ventricular system, right from lateral ventricles down all the way through the fourth ventricle, foramen oblongata. These are all lined. The ventricles are lined by a ciliated epithelium called ependymal cells. Now, when a neoplasm arises from these cells, they can be classified as ependymal cell tumor. There are two types of this. One is ependymoma and the second is subependymoma. Of this, the more malignant is the ependymoma and more benign is the subependymoma. Both these arise along the ependymal lining. So let's start with the subependymoma, which is more benign. Now the picture over here is of an ependymoma. The subependymoma is a more solid tumor. It is a very slow growing tumor. Some people almost classify it as a benign tumor. It is a WHO-1 classification tumor. It does not metastasize, or very, very infrequently, if ever, will metastasize. It is confined, just as this description is, it is subependymal in location. It is iso to hypointense on T1, it will be as I had mentioned earlier, masses have mass effect. So this will be a mass lesion with a very narrow zone of transition, iso to hypointense on T1, slight hyperintense on T2 examination, generally a solid. It may approach heterogeneity if it gets very big and is almost never associated with enhancement. Once resected, it is almost like treated. The second form is, which is the more malignant one, is the ependymoma, which again arises from the ciliated cells, ependymal lining, which can arise anywhere from the lateral ventricle superior frontal horn aspect down to the fourth ventricle. Now both ependymoma and subependymoma frequently arise from fourth ventricle. Most common location, about greater than 50%, are in the fourth ventricle. And ependymoma happens to be the more aggressive one, which is generally low intensity on T1, hyperintense on T2, frequently associated with cystic foci or microcystic foci, can have fine calcifications which are not clearly or obviously seen, but can be appreciated on SWI images, not so frequently seen on CT images, and is associated with intense enhancement in its solid component. Now this solid component is the main tumor, and this solid component will show enhancement and may frequently show areas of restricted diffusion because of its cellularity. It is also associated with areas of hemorrhage, again, which will be appreciated on the SWI images. This is classified as WHO and frequently 2 and frequently as WHO 3, as far as the tumor, just because of its aggressive nature. When it extends into the brain parenchyma, it causes a significant vasogenic reaction. It has T2 hyperintensity, wide zone of transition, frequently associated with a hydrocephalus, which may both be related to cell debris metastasis, like as in seen in choroid plexus papilloma or papillary carcinoma, or may be related to obstructive hydrocephalus. Both of these conditions, entities can do that, causing hydrocephalus. Now, the important thing about this is it breaches the ependymal lining. So it is directly exposed as a neoplasm within the ventricular lining. It can cause drop metastasis. It can metastasize anywhere along the neural axis. So our job, when this patient comes in and we see a mass lesion in a lobulated fashion extending into the ventricular lining. Now, this may be not specific for ependymoma. It will be common for medulloblastoma, choroid plexus papilloma, choroid plexus papillary carcinoma, or even if you see a central neurocytoma, which generally does not cause any drop metastasis. But once it is there, extending into the central cavity of the CSF, our job is to do imaging of the entire neural axis. The patient should not go home from the MR scanner without getting a full neural axis examination and to evaluate for drop metastasis, which will be seen as leptomeningeal enhancement, nodularity along the corpus callosum. So these kind of things. So we will have to image the entire neural axis pre and post contrast. So this is a case of ependymoma. It's a pretty aggressive neoplasm, has a solid cystic component, has intense enhancement. This is another case. Again, this is projecting into the brain parenchyma, has a solid and a cystic component, intense enhancement of the solid component. And here, if you see, the periphery of the cyst is also enhancing. That means this is not an cyst as seen with hemangioblastoma or juvenile pilocytic astrocytoma, but the cyst is not component of neoplasm. The solid component is the component of neoplasm. In this case, the entire cyst is enhancing. The cyst is also a component of the neoplasm. And when the surgeon goes in, he has to dissect the entire cystic as well as solid component, unlike what we see in hemangioblastoma, where only the solid component needs to be dissected. So this is a very aggressive form of ependymoma projecting into the brain parenchyma. And in this case, there was no leptomeningeal enhancement. There was no drop metastasis. But once you see this condition extending into the ventricle lining, in the last sagittal and coronal sequences, you can see it extends and aborts the ventricle lining. So this is an ependymoma. Can be confused as an glioblastoma multiforme, but this turned out to be an ependymoma. Once you see this, you do an entire neural axis examination. Once again, the important thing in this case, when the patient is in the MR scanner, is to call the clinician and tell him about the herniation, because that is what is going to kill the patient, not this tumor immediately, but this mass effect and herniation can decompensate and kill the patient within a matter of a day. So this is what we have to mention and call the clinician and see what he wants, whether he wants the patient to go to the ER or to his clinic, but this patient should not go home from this point. So these are the two main entities arising from the ependymal lining, which is ependymoma, which is the malignant one, subependymoma, which is a benign one. Moving on to the next tumor cell line, we would be talking about the choroidal cell lines. This is the cells which are lining the choroidal matter. So this is, if we as we know, the choroid plexus extends from the lateral ventricles, passing through the foramen Munro, and then through the third ventricle into the fourth ventricle, and from there into the foramen of Luschka. So as by definition, a tumor arising from these choroidal cells can arise anywhere along the choroid plexus. These two. So a cauliflower sitting in the left atrial region, lateral ventricle, intense enhancement associated hydrocephalus. This is not touching the ependymal lining. This is arising from the choroid plexus. So this would be a classic choroid plexus papilloma or papillary carcinoma, but in this case, the choroid plexus papilloma. Now another one, this is a pediatric patient, isointense to gray matter signal intensity, iso to hyperintense T2 signal in the same area, lobulated cauliflower type of lesion, intense enhancement clearly associated and attached to the choroid plexus, severe hydrocephalus. Unless proven otherwise, this is going to be choroid plexus papilloma or papillary carcinoma. And if we, again, this is a situation just like we talked about in ependymomas, you see this thing, it is our moral responsibility to image the entire neural axis and look for drop metastasis. And that is what we will be using to differentiate between choroid plexus versus papillary carcinoma. So this is an aggressive form. This is not WHO1. This would be WHO2 or WHO3. It's an aggressive neoplasm. It can invade the surrounding soft tissue. It can invade the brain parenchyma. It can be associated with areas of hemorrhage. It is frequently, in fact, almost very, very commonly associated with drop metastasis, can be evaluated by CSF evaluation. By imaging, it will still be a large cauliflower-shaped, intensely enhancing lesion sitting inside the ventricular system, anywhere within the atrial region, which is the most common area in children, or within the fourth ventricle, which is the most common area within the adult patient. Now, choroid plexus papillary carcinoma almost exclusively happens in children. Very rarely does it happen in adult patients. So this thing would be shedding tumor cells into the CSF. Moving on, I would like to mention another tumor which is arising in the ventricular system. Although we talked about conditions such as ependymoma, subependymoma, choroid plexus papilloma, papillary carcinoma, there are many other lesions that can arise from the ventricular lining or ventricular system, such as central neurocytoma or SEGA or giant cell astrocytoma, which is frequently seen in tuberous sclerosis, or meningioma, or some normal variants like K1 septum pellucidum, K1 vergae, K1 interpositum, or you can see arachnoid cyst or infections such as neurocystic sarcosis. All these things arise in the ventricle lining, but of these I would like to mention the choroid cyst over here at this point. So choroid cyst is basically a primitive neuroepithelium arising neoplasm that contains mucin, blood, old blood products, cholesterol, ions in different combinations. And depending upon these combinations, it gives you a different picture on MR sequences. So it is a very variable picture. It can be T1 hyperintense to T1 hypointense. It can be T2 hyperintense to T2 hypointense. And it can give you any signal on MRC. So in no specific signal is characteristic of a choroid cyst. But what is very classic is it is almost always, almost 100% of the time, positive on CT as a hyperdense lesion. CT is much more sensitive, where it is 95% positive on CT and only 60 to 75% sensitive on MRI examination. So this the study of choice in a choroid cyst would be a CT examination, not an MRI examination. Now this presentation is somewhat classic for a choroid cyst, where this is a pedunculated lesion that is adjacent to the foramen Munro. So occasionally, depending on which side the patient is lying, it causes occlusion of the foramen Munro and hydrocephalus or headache. So it will present with positional headache. That with this hyperdense focus in this area is pathognomic for a choroid cyst. Now, one thing that you have to differentiate is an aneurysm arising from an anterior communicating artery, which is projecting superiorly. That is the critical thing. You don't want to put in a needle without knowing that this is an choroid cyst, definitely, or it is an aneurysm arising from the anterior communicating artery. So that is one test you want to make sure that you do. The important thing about this is it can cause positional instant complete occlusion of CSF drainage and severe hydrocephalus, which can potentially kill the patient. So this is a potentially fatal entity. Even though it looks very benign, most of the time, almost majority of the time, it is incidentally detected. Patient doesn't come specifically with headache. And that generally, depending on the size, it can be associated with a mild, moderate, or severe hydrocephalus. Majority of the time, when we see it incidentally, it is not associated with any hydrocephalus. Classic presentation, hyperdense cyst situated at the foramen of Munro on CT examination. MR is somewhat unreliable. Here we see an example of that. It can be very, very variable on intensities, almost never associated with enhancement internally. May have a mild form of capsular enhancement, if at all, but enhancement is not any special attribute to this lesion. It is not associated with restricted diffusion. It is not associated with any pulsation artifact, which would be differentiating it from on the phase direction on an anterior communicating artery. So moving on, when we see an intraventricular mass, how do we approach it? So if it is a solid, completely intraventricular mass lesion, intensely enhancing, not associated with any of the choroid plexus lining or the ependymal lining, associated with restricted diffusion, unless proven otherwise, it would be a meningioma. If it is an entirely cystic component, complete cyst, CSF intensity or mixed signal intensity, the differential would be arachnoid cyst when it is CSF intensity, cystic sarcosis when it is CSF intensity, neuroepithelial cyst when it is CSF intensity, choroid cyst, which we just talked about, would be variable intensity. Then most of the time, what we'll be seeing is mixed signal, mixed appearance, both solid and cystic component. Now, then we talked about this when it is attached to wall or choroid lining. That is what will differentiate it. When it is attached to the wall, then it will be an ependymoma or subependymoma. When it attached to the septum pellucidum, then it is going to be a central neurocytoma. If it is associated with foramen of Munro, a lobulated mass in a patient with tuberous sclerosis, we will call it a SEGA or subependymal giant cell astrocytoma. When it is not attached to the periphery, when it is centrally located, attached to the choroid plexus, it is going to be a choroid plexus tumor or a choroid plexus metastasis. Now, choroid plexus metastasis, we generally tend to underrate it. There are very, very common choroid plexus metastasis in a patient with diffuse metastatic disease. If you do the histology, more often than not, we will find tumor cells within the choroid plexus also. So we should not disregard this entity. And the other would be a blood clot associated with the choroid plexus, a hematoma formation. That would be the thing that we would, and once it gets organized, it can potentially enhance and give a mass-like appearance. So this is how you would approach an interventricular tumor.